Hello, Chicago. I remember when I was younger, I used to come Purim to Chicago as a bacher. I'll never forget those Purims. They were awesome. In the 1990s, I was growing up, an avid basketball fan. I wished I was a citizen of Chicago back then. And I'm really, really glad to be here. Bereshus the Rosh Yeshiva, the wonderful Rebbeim that I had an opportunity to meet tonight. And everyone here tonight, thank you for coming out and supporting the yeshiva. It's really a great honor and privilege to be here. So around a half a year ago, I was shopping at a local Jewish supermarket in LA. I'm from Los Angeles. And as I was checking out, I heard someone yell my name and said, "Rabbi Gold, Rabbi Gold." I turn around and I see this middle-aged woman. And she says, "Rabbi Gold, I got a great story for you." I have people all the time coming over and sharing stories with me. So I always tell my brother, who's in real estate, by the way, I tell him, "Mayor, whatever a good piece of real estate is for you, that's what a good true story is for me." I put my bags down and I'm all ears. And she says, "My daughter was walking on La Brea Avenue. That's the main thoroughfare in LA. She was walking past a young Israel. And she said to me, she said, 'Ma, I noticed there was an officer issuing a ticket to a car that was parked by an expired meter. And I noticed that the car was parked in front of a young Israel. I looked at the car, I looked at the officer, I looked at the young Israel, and I realized that it must belong to someone davening mincha right now in young Israel. I knew he couldn't come out. So I ran over to the officer and advocated on his behalf, and I said, 'Officer, I think this fellow is davening mincha. He can't come out. Do you mind if I put in a quarter on his behalf?' The officer turns to the girl, to this little girl, and he says, he was very, very impressed, obviously, and he says, 'You know, you're in luck. I still didn't print the ticket.' She puts the quarter in the meter, the officer walks away. And I'm about to walk away, and I thank the woman. I say, 'Wow, this is a wonderful story. It's a reflection of the beautiful chinuch you invested in your child, in your daughter. Thank you so much for sharing.' And I'm about to walk away, and she says, 'Rabbi Gold, where are you going?' I said, 'The story is not over.' And she says, 'No.' She says, 'My daughter decided to wait and see whose car it was, because she thought maybe it belongs to someone down the block eating at McDonald's and couldn't find a parking spot other than in front of young Israel. She waits 10 minutes, people file out of young Israel, and 'Rabbi Gold, you would never believe this.' I said, 'What?' 'It was your car.' You know, it's amazing. It's amazing how a story, when it becomes personal, it becomes sensational. I went to Coffee Bean, I bought a $25 gift card for the girl, and as I was going over to her house, wrote a thank you note, dropping it off, and I thought to myself, who else in my life has been putting in quarters in my meter, even when I was parked illegally, and I didn't think? I can tell you that in preparation for this event, I had so many phone calls with so many different people. Behind the scenes, a lot of work went into tonight. And I want to thank Rabbi Gershon Seif, Rabbi Shmuel Schumann, and Rabbi Josh Zisok, and everybody else there Rabbi Ari mentioned before, because so much work and effort went into tonight, and I pray and I hope that it's successful and we're all inspired together over the next few minutes. So I want to talk to you about the most important topic in your life. So you're probably thinking to yourself, Rabbi Gold, who are you to tell me what the most important topic in my life is, A, and what is it, and how do you know? So, I want to share with you a study. In 1938, a group of researchers at Harvard conducted one of the most incredible studies ever done. They started tracking the lives of 724 kids from all different backgrounds in the Boston area. They went to their schools, their homes. They monitored their behaviors. They listen to their conversations. They observe their interactions. They check their blood, scan their brains. They documented every detail in their life. They did this once a year, every year for 75 years. It took them four generations of researchers to complete this study. Why? Why did they do this? They wanted to find out what keeps people happy and fulfilled as they go through life. And here's what they found. It all comes down to just two words. Good relationships. Those kids who throughout their lives had positive, healthy, strong interpersonal relationships were significantly happier and more fulfilled than anyone else in the group. You know what I found fascinating? It took Harvard 75 years, four generations of researchers, and thousands of papers of information to figure out what David HaMelech sums up in just a few words, thousands of years ago. And he says, who is a person who wants life? But not just any life. He wants oyhev yomim. He wants to love his days, to feel happy, lirais toiv, to see the good, to be fulfilled. It all comes down to netzar l'shoincha. Watch what you say about other people. Asay toiv. Be careful with how you treat other people. Bakei shalom, generate goodwill. Pursue peace. Because David HaMelech understood so long ago that the cornerstone of a happy and fulfilling life is good relationships. I remember when I moved to LA, my wife is from LA, I'm from Brooklyn, and we moved, and Los Angeles has a very big health culture, and I started shopping at this local health food store after a few months living there. And over time, I became very health conscious. I cut the sugar out of my diet, chocolate out of my diet, cake, anything. Any junk food was out of my diet, and one day I decided to take it to the next level, juicing. I decided to start juicing fresh green vegetables every single day. I'll never forget this. I was so excited. I ran to Best Buy, and I bought myself the most expensive juicer on the shelf. I went to the local health food store, bought myself the freshest, greenest, most organic vegetables I can find, and I brought it all home. And I started juicing breakfast, lunch, and supper. And by the end of the day, I was expecting to feel really healthy, vibrant, energetic. And to my great dismay, I felt sick. I felt like my abdomen was about to explode. And I remember turning to my wife, and I said, "Honey, why am I feeling this way? I consumed so many vitamins and nutrients today." And she compassionately turned to me, and she said, "Yoel, I think it's the juice." I said, "The juice?" You know how they say in every relationship? You know how they say that every relationship, one is always right, the other is the husband? Anybody ever experienced that? Why only the men laughing? And my wife was right. Turned out that I overjuiced. I was laying in bed and I remember having an epiphany. I like to call it an aha moment. And I was thinking to myself, isn't it amazing? You could have the best tools. You could have the freshest vegetables and the noblest of intentions. But if you don't know how to use what you have effectively, you'll never get the results you're looking for, period. So if we're talking about good relationships, you're probably thinking to yourself, "Rabbi, yeah, I know, don't speak Lashon Hara, Hakar Satov, and all the great virtues and ingredients we talk about all our lives. But I want to talk to you tonight how to apply it effectively. How do we apply it, bin Adam l'chaveir, to our friends, to our marriages, with our children?" I want to share with you three lessons I learned from a jigsaw puzzle, and I schlepped this all the way from Los Angeles, so you better pay attention. I have over here two giant pieces of jigsaw puzzle. You can tell over here, One is blue, the other is red. They're different shapes, different sizes. I tend to look at people like a jigsaw puzzle. Everybody is different. Every single person is different. Different color, different shades, different sizes, different shapes. We're all different. When we talk about relationships, we have to embrace the fact that our wives, our husbands, our children, everybody is different. You know, Rav Hirsch writes, he says that the word shav in vain and the word shaveh, same, are similar. Why? He says the reason is because anything that's the same as anything else is shav. Anything that's shav is shav. Hashem doesn't create two people alike. What does he need two of the same people for? In the Haftarah and Parshas Vayechi, we read, David HaMelech says to Shlomo, the last words he says, Hinei Anoichi Oilech Baderech Kol Aretz, behold, I'm going in the path of the rest of the land, V'chazakto V'ayisa L'ish, says the Chasam Sofer. He says, why does he say, Hinei Anoichi Oilech Baderech Kol Aretz? Why does he use a euphemism? Why doesn't he say, Hinei Anoichi Oilech Lamas, I'm about to die? Why does he use an analogy for death and uses the words, Anoichi Oilech Baderech Kol Aretz, I'm going in the path of the rest of the land? Chasam Sofer says, you know why? Because the only time you follow somebody else, you copy somebody else, is when you die. That's when you're a hoylech b'derech kol haaretz. Otherwise, if you're alive and you're breathing, v'chazakta v'hayisa l'ish, you got to be an individual. You're created different. Everybody has a different koyach. You're not the same as anybody else. My name is Yoeli. I grew up Hasidish in Williamsburg. I learned in Litvashi yeshivas. I married a Sephardi girl, and I'm a rabbi of a Yekesh Shul. All true. And I can tell you, if you ask each group, sum up Yiddishkeit in two words, they all have a different answer. You ask my father, who wears a shtraimel, a Hasidish, a Yid, he'll tell you, tefillah v'chesed. You ask my chavrusa, a Litvak, he'll tell you, Talmud Teira. You ask my father-in-law, a good Sephardi Jew, he'll say, Amunah bitachon. You ask a Yaki, the president of my shul, he'll tell you, everything depends on being on time. The world revolves about being on time. Everybody, so who's right? Everybody is right. Because everybody has a different tafkid. Everybody brings another value to the world, another strength to the world. So if everybody is so different, everybody brings a different strength, so how do we connect? How do we connect with others if we're that different? So I want to show you something here. You see, every puzzle piece has protruding knobs, and they also have holes. The protruding knob symbolizes the gifts, the talents, the skills that HaKadosh Baruch Hu has given us. They are our knobs. We stick out. We stand out. Hashem says, you're good at this, and you'll be good at that. And at the same time, you also have a need. There's a hole. Some people have a hole, one hole with a rough edge. Other people don't have rough edges, but they have two holes. Everybody is different. Everybody has milas and chesroinus. Different milas, different chesroinus. What do you do with the knobs and the holes? The point of connection is, when I recognize my family, my shul, my community, I realize, yes, there is a need. But instead of judging, instead of standing and complaining, I recognize in myself the knob that Hashem has given me, and I put the knob and fill the void, and that's how I connect. That's the essence of relationships. And that's the essence of connection. I see what you need, I recognize what I have, and I apply my milus to your chasroinus without judgment, recognizing that that's the way HaKadosh Baruch Hu created the world, lahakayos behem, nefesh kol choy. Fellow sent me an email a few months ago. He said he was traveling, Chassid Shagai, he was traveling, his name is Mr. Alter, he was traveling with his family to Europe, a gerach chusid. He went to visit Poland, Warsaw. The climax, the culmination of the trip was Eretz Yisrael. They went to Eretz Yisrael at the end, and of course, the climax of Eretz Yisrael was visiting the Kaisel. They go to the Kaisel HaMaravi, and of course, you have to walk through security before you get in to the Kaisel Plaza. So this guy with all of his kids, his wife, they walk through and they give the bags to the Chayel standing behind the table who's checking all the bags, making sure there are no dangerous items in there. And all of a sudden he hears the Chayel screaming and yelling in Ivrit. He yells, Shel mi atikazeh? Shel mi atikazeh? Whose bag is this? And the guy looks around, Mr. Alter looks back and he sees that it's his wife's pocketbook. It's his wife's bag. He turns to his wife and he says, what do you have in your bag? She says, I don't know. Listen, we've been traveling for 2 weeks. And we went through so many security checkpoints. Nobody stopped me. I don't even know. So he says, let me take care of this. When he walks over to the Chayal with bag in hand, and he says, it's my wife's. Ech afshar lazor, ma ba'ya? The Chayal sticks his hand into the bag, takes out a bottle of Advil, and he says, yesh li ke'ef shinayim, ani yechol lekachat kama kadurim. I have a toothache, and I have some. Can I have some Advil? And he said, at that point, he felt so close, a chassid shayid with a chayal, because there was a void that he was able to fill. He was able to give him a few Advil for his toothache. That's all it takes to recognize a need and fill that void. That's the definition of connection. Mi yoesh lechof etz chayim. Oyev yomam liris toiv, asay toiv, bake shalom. Look around you. People are in pain, emotional pain. A good word, listen to their comments, listen to them. That's the essence of connection. That's why we're here. Chaim Volozhiner writes that Odom lo la'atzmo nivra, we were created for other people. And like a puzzle, Rabbi Yisai, different pieces, different knobs, different holes. Shalom, peace, also means complete, because that's how we complete the greater picture, the purpose of life. When we fill our husbands, our wife's needs, our children's needs, by recognizing what HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave us. I'll tell you a very, very good story. My cousin told me, he's a criminal lawyer. He retired a year ago and he started doing real estate. And he has real estate all over the country, very successful. And his name is Frank Mandel. And he was sitting on a flight, on an American Airlines flight in Newark Airport. This is a great story, one of my favorites. In Newark Airport, he's sitting in an American Airlines flight next to his business partner. His business partner's name is Chaim Kaufman. Now, the pilot gets onto the intercom and he says, passengers, please turn off all of your electronic devices and prepare for takeoff. So Chaim hears all of your electronic devices and immediately puts his hand in his pocket and he says, Frank, I gotta make one last phone call. Frank says, the pilot just told everyone to turn off their electronic devices. And I says, no, this is really important. He puts his hand in his pocket, looks for his phone, and realizes, oh no, he forgot his phone at the charging station by the gate. So he panics, and there are a lot of young guys over here, and I see everybody knows from this generation that your entire life is on your phone. You know, if you're going to a business meeting in Dallas, you have your schedules, your contacts, your meetings, everything is on that phone. He turns to Frank, says, Frank, I got everything on the PowerPoint presentation, everything is on that phone. He says, what am I supposed to do? There was a flight attendant walking past, his name is Steve Cooley. I spoke to Steve to verify the story, by the way. Steve Cooley walks past in the aisle, grabs his jacket, and he says, Steve, do me a favor. I know that the plane is already inching out of the gate. It's moving. I forgot my phone at the charging station. Do me a favor. I know that I can't get it back right now, but at least contact the gate. They should put it in lost and found, so when I come back, I at least get my phone back. Steve says, hang in. He disappears for 5 minutes in the cockpit, comes out, goes over to Chaim Kaufman, hands him his phone and the charger, and he says, please don't forget it again. Chaim looks at Steve. And he says, how'd you get that phone? Plane is moving. Steve says, I'll tell you. The pilot, when he heard that someone forgot his phone at the charging station, he was in touch with the air traffic controller at the tower. The air traffic controller at the tower notified an agent at the gate. The agent at the gate ran to the charging station, grabbed the phone of the charger, ran out into the tarmac, noticed a truck with a scissor lift. Those lifts used to put the food onto the plane, those carts on the... He runs over to the truck driver, and he says, "Sir, do you see that plane, flight number 1509, that's heading onto the runway right now, inching on?" Says, "This belongs to one of the passengers. Please get it over to the pilot." The truck driver, true story, by the way, on the tarmac, heads over to the plane, lifts the scissor lift. The pilot opens up the cockpit window, throws the phone and charger into the cockpit, gives it to Steve Cooley, and Steve Cooley hands it back to Chaim Kaufman. I said, "Frank, it's amazing. Were you flying business class by any chance?" He says, "Yes." Okay. Don't expect it in economy. So Frank turns to Chaim and he says, "You know, you told me you had to make an important call. You realize had you not wanted to make that call, you probably never would have gotten your phone back. Who did you want to call?" So Chaim says, "I have an elderly mother, and I try to call her every night to say goodnight. And I remembered I didn't call her tonight. So I said, 'Frank, so what'd you tell him?' He said, 'The lesson of the story is, I told him that when you think of someone else, great things happen.' I said, 'That's cliche. I have a different lesson. Always fly American Airlines.'" The truth is, if you think about it, how many people did it take to return Chaim Kaufman's onto the plane? Chaim Kaufman's phone. So I made a cheshbon. It took the pilot. It took the flight attendant. It took the air traffic controller at the tower. It took the agent at the gate and the truck driver who drove over with a scissor lift. Five people. And it occurred to me there's a pasuk in Parshas Bechukosai. It says, "Chamisha mikem mea yerdoifu." Hashem says that you'll be able to chase away 100 of your enemies with five people. Moira v'rabbi the Rechaim HaKadosh asks, how can five people chase away 100? It doesn't make any sense. It's impossible. It's just impossible. Says the Rechaim HaKadosh, you forgot what it says in a pasuk previous before that. It says, "V'nasati shalom ba'aretz." I'll put peace in your land. There'll be peace. You know what shalom is? That each of those five people will know their role. They'll come from a different background. Maybe one will speak Yiddish, the other will speak Hebrew, the other will speak English. They'll have different strengths and they'll work together. If there's shalom between five people, then yes, mea yerdoifu, we can accomplish the impossible. We can't have judgment. We have to recognize Hashem created everybody different. Milas chesroinus. The point of connection is when we use our milas to fill Yenam's chesroinus. That's shalom. That's peace. That's completion. I want to end with one. I have two stories, but I'm speaking for too long. I'm going to tell you one story, and then I'll end with this. When my wife and I were expecting our first child, I got a phone call from my wife's family. She comes from a Sephardi family, and some of you might know by Sephardim, the minhag is to name the grandson after the grandfather who's still alive. Now, by Hasidim, that's Yehorek Vel Yavr. You never do that. So I really wanted to do it for my wife's family, but it wasn't my minig, and I didn't know what to do. So I was talking to my father-in-law, who is the sweetest Jew alive, and I said, "Abba, I'll tell you what. Let's go over to the Gadol Hadar. Let's ask him what to do." So I lived in Eretz Yisrael at the time, and we went over to Rav Chaim Kanievsky. So we drove down to Bnei Brak, walked into Rav Chaim, and I never saw Rav Chaim laugh. I presented the shaila and I said, "You know, my wife is expecting and the doctors said it's going to be a boy, and we don't know what to do, what to name. And in Yiddish, he laughs and he says, "En efshir v'tazayin ha-meidela, and maybe it's going to be a girl. You won't have the issue." So then I really got nervous because I wanted a boy, and the doctor said a boy, Rav Chaim said a girl. But okay, it turned out Rav Chaim didn't want to answer the shaila because it wasn't relevant yet. Anyways, the end of the story was our son was born. And I didn't want to go back to Rav Chaim simply because I heard that he said no to somebody else. And once he says no, I can't do it. So I went to a different Rav. He said, you can add a name. Okay, I wanted peace. So I took the easy way out. I named my son Yosef, which is my father-in-law's name. And I added a name after a dead grandfather too, to be Yotze Shnei Shitas Kalashitas. I named him Yosef Chaim. The Sfardim, I tell it's after the Ben Ishchai. The Ashkenazim, I tell it's after Rabbi Yosef Chaim Zonnefeld. And everybody's very happy. By the way, a few years later, I bought a program called Bar Ilan. You could type in names and see the gematria, which pasuk it's the gematria of. And when I got that program, I told my wife, what if we type in Yoel, which is my name, Varachel, which is her name. I said, what if we type both names in? What would happen? She says, let's try it. We tried it. And it's a pasuk in Parshas Vayechi, the exact gematria of Hine Bincha Yosef Ba. So I was eating by my Rebbe's house, Rav Asher Arieli. And he asked me, he says, what's your son's name? I learned in the mirror at the time. And Friday night, my wife and I and my son, he said, what's your son's name? I said, my son's name is Yosef Chaim. And I proceeded to tell him the entire story. So he became serious and he says, let me tell you a story. He says, when my wife was pregnant, he said to me, she had a very difficult pregnancy. And the doctors, they weren't sure if she'd have more children. And it was a boy. And I wanted to name my son after my father. My wife, we weren't sure what's going to happen in the future. She wanted to name this son, this child, after her father, who happened to be Rav Asher Arieli's Rebbe, Rav Nachum Partsavitch, who was a son of Rav Chaim Shmulevitz. So they didn't know what to do. So Rav Asher said to me, he said, I went to Rav Elyashiv. I went to ask the God of Adar. So he went to ask Rav Yashiv, and Rav Yashiv says, what do you mean? It's Allah and Shulchan Aruch. You have to name your son after your father, because Kavod Aviv Kaidim L'Kavod Chamev. Your father's honor comes before the honor of your father-in-law. So here's what Rav Asher tells Rav Yashiv, and with this I'll end. This is unbelievable. By the way, this is the best shir that I ever heard from my Rebbe, Rav Asher Arieli. He said to me, he said, I turned to Rav Yashiv and he said, yeah, Ich weiß der Halach in Shulchan Aruch. I know the Halach in Shulchan Aruch. I came here because I'm afraid to go against the Shulchan Aruch, and I really want to be mevater. I want to give to my wife. I just need a heter from the Rav to go against the Psak of Shulchan Aruch. That's called giving. He could have had the trump card. Come back to his wife, remember, Asher said, it's my name. That's it, Shalom HaYisrael. Whatever Shalom is worth, that Shalom is not worth anything, but whatever it's worth for, Shalom HaYisrael. His wife would have bit her lips, and that's it. He said, no. I asked Rav Yashiv because I wanted to give. I had a protruding knob, she had a void, and I was able to fill it, and I was eager to fill it. My only concern was not to go against the Shulchan Aruch. Tonight, as we walk out of here, and by the way, this event is beautiful, very unique. I've never been at such an event. This is amazing, by the way, and I'm looking forward to shoot some hoops downstairs after this. But before we go, I want you to ask yourself one question. And with this, I'm ending. Do you know what your protruding knob is? In the context of your relationship with your wife, with your husband, with your children, can you identify the koiches, the skill, the talent that Hashem has given you? And can you be compassionate to somebody else's hole? And do you have the courage to fill it and make that connection? May Hashem help all of us. Shabbi Zoicha. To ois shalom b'mroim avo yasu shalom aleinu. Shabbi Zoicha to bias mashiach tetkenu b'meir b'meinu amen. Thank you so much for inviting me.